Let's wrap up this lesson by learning a few new adverbs by category, along with our first adjective and our first noun. After parting ways with the shepherd in the woods, Joel continues home through the plaza. In lesson one, he was in a hurry, and the only thing we learned there was the word no, to mean not. But today, Joel has decided that he does want to look around and see what the vendors here in the plaza have to offer. So when they ask him, "Do you want to see what we have to sell?" Joel answers, "Yes." But to say yes, Joel uses the word see. Now, this means something like yes, but not exactly. It also means something like indeed. Basically, it's exchangeable with the word no, which means not, but it means the opposite. Here are some examples. I don't want to buy something would be I no want to buy something. But I do want to buy something would be I see want to buy something. As you can see, it's the exact same sentence structure. A shorter example would be he wasn't happy is he no was happy. And he was happy is he see was happy. Now, there's no way to translate these sentences completely literally. Just remember that the next time you use no in Spanish to mean not, you could use see there to emphasize that something is true. Here's an example. If someone is saying that somebody wasn't here, in English we might say, but he was here. We're emphasizing that it was true. Now, if we just said he was here, the sentence is true by default, but we emphasize, he was here. In Spanish, we would say, sí, he was here.
Sí, estaba aquí.
Now, when Joel uses this word, he goes up to the top of the statue in the middle of the plaza. He does this so that he can look around to see what he does indeed want to buy, or what he sí wants to buy. Meanwhile, the word no is going to be stored on the ground behind the statue, which is where Joel wants to be if he doesn't want to buy anything, because that's on the way home. So in future lessons, we're going to keep using the statue in the middle of the plaza to store yes-no words. But there are other places throughout the plaza that we'll use to store other adverbs. So if you were to look around this marketplace, you would see different categories of food. First, you would see the fresh flesh meat stand, which is where Joel buys one of his favorite foods, steak. Next, you would see the baker's stand, called Grains Today Without Delay. This is where Joel tries to buy bread. Next, you would see Foreign Fruits, which sells an entire catalog of fruits from many different locations around the planet. Then, finally, we have Quality Vegetables, which sells other kinds of produce. Let's jump in and start with steak. Joel is dubious of the quality of this steak. He's very picky, and something smells very strange here. So he asks the butcher, "How fresh is this steak?" "Oh, it's very fresh," responds the butcher. "How fresh?" asks Joel. Suddenly, Joel hears a moo sound coming from the steak. It sounds like a cow mooing. Wow, this steak must be very fresh if it's mooing. So the butcher once again emphasizes, "It's very fresh." He says, "It's muy fresh." The word muy means very. Now I have to point out that many English speakers learn this word but mispronounce it, saying moy or something like that. That's an error that we make because the oi sound is so common in English. It's not as common in Spanish. So to avoid this mistake, always remember the moo sound, like a cow, to emphasize that something is muy fresh. As you might imagine, this is a very common adverb, or a muy common adverb. You're likely to use it quite frequently. Fortunately, it's pretty easy to use because it corresponds directly with the English word very. It's almost perfectly equivalent. Now, before we move on from the steak stand, note that this place is where we're going to learn adverbs that are related to degree. For example, a person can be a very tall person, but they can also be kinda tall, less tall, more tall, and so on. Anything that can be exchanged with very is going to be kept here. But right now, we don't have any more words at this stand, so we'll move on to the bread stand. This place is interesting because there's a strange dynamic between Joel and the baker, based on two funny facts. First of all, even though this stand is officially called Grains Today Without Delay, the baker is actually very reluctant to sell his bread. He's a complete hypocrite, and he always has some sort of excuse for not selling anything. In fact, Joel has never, ever seen anyone buy anything from this place successfully. Second, Joel himself doesn't even like bread or grains of any kind. But at the same time, he comes to this stand all the time with mischievous motives. It's a challenge for him. Will he succeed in convincing the baker to sell something today? So the baker doesn't want to sell anything, and Joel doesn't like bread, but tries to buy from him anyway. This makes for some very interesting stories. Today, Joel is not successful. As soon as he comes up to the stand and asks if he can buy bread, the baker recognizes Joel and knows what he's up to. He says, "Oh, sorry, it's too late. The stand is now closed." Joel says, "Already?" "Yeah," says the baker. "The store is closed. Yeah!" And as he says that, he slams down the sliding front of the stand to close it. He does this so hastily that he doesn't even think about the fact that he's left a knife in a piece of bread sticking off the front of the stand. So as the wooden cover comes down, it hits the knife, which cracks it. The word "ya" is very confusing for English speakers, even though it's the most frequently used adverb that's related to time. So in English, our favorite time-related adverb is the word "now," as in, "Now I'm at home," or "Now the store is closed." But that word doesn't translate directly into other languages. The word "ya" basically means that something has just changed. Many people translate it as "already," but that doesn't usually work. "Ya" actually means something more like "any more." Okay, we've been really abstract so far, so let's use an example. When the baker slammed the stand closed to get rid of Joel, he said that the stand is "ya closed." That could mean "already closed." Most Spanish speakers would say "ya the store is closed" to mean "now the store is closed" or "already the store is closed." So as you can see, "ya" is happening at the beginning of these sentences. But they would also say something like, "ya the store isn't open," which means "the store isn't open anymore." So here, "ya" means "anymore." But once again, it occurs at the beginning of the sentence. "Ya, the store is closed." "Ya, the store isn't open." So what does "ya" mean exactly? Ultimately, it's the most frequently used translation for "now," "already," or "anymore." And again, it's used in these cases when something has changed, and it emphasizes the fact that something has changed, kind of like a wooden lid slamming down and being split open with a knife. So to say "the store is closed already," you would say, "Ya, the store is closed." To say "now the store is closed," you would say, "Ya, the store is closed." To say "the store isn't open anymore," you would say, "Ya, no, the store is open." Let's hear some real examples. "I already know that they were." So that's "ya, I know, que lo eran."
"Ya sé que lo eran."
The next one would be translated as "but they aren't anymore." "Pero ya no lo son."
"Pero ya no lo son."
In some cases, "ya" doesn't even seem to relate to time at all. There's a little phrase called "ya que." So it's just the word "ya" followed by our connecting word "que." What does that mean? Does it mean "already that"? or any more that? This is very idiomatic and doesn't translate literally, which is frequently the case with the word ya. Basically, ya que means given that, or since as a connector. And it tends to be followed by a complete sentence. So the example that I'll give you is, I can help you with that, given that we're friends. Or I'll help you with that since we're friends. That would be, te, I'll help con eso, ya que somos friends.
Te ayudo con eso, ya que somos amigos.
With phrases like this, you basically just have to practice examples, and then it becomes second nature eventually. Let's get back to the story. Joel's a bit upset that the stand isn't open anymore, so he goes over to the next place in the plaza. At Foreign Fruits, Joel asks the merchant if they have any fruit from Mount Rhea, one of the most mysterious foreign places on the planet of Yol. Yes, I think so, says the clumsy merchant. Let me see, I think we keep it in a locked drawer back here. Where's the key? Joel rolls his eyes and points to something that's sticking out of a fruit right in front of the merchant's nose. What's that? He asks. Oh, says the merchant, it's a key. The word a key sounds like a key, but what it means is here. So it's a key means it's here, right in front of my nose, maybe. We're storing this word at the fruit stand because the fruit stand is where we store adverbs that are related to location. Specifically, this is going to be stored using a key sticking out of a fruit in the middle of his basket. Going back to an example that we used earlier, to say, he was here, or he was indeed here, you would say, sí, he was here, or sí, he was aquí.
Sí estaba aquí.
Joel is annoyed by the fruit merchant and his absent-mindedness, so he goes over to the quality vegetable stand. This one is run by a farmer who happens to be a monkey. Now, the first thing that Joel notices, since he's very money-minded, is that there's a can where the monkey receives cash. This farming monkey is very proud of the fact that he's able to accept many kinds of currency. Joel notices that the can has symbols for US dollars, British pounds, and several others. But what about yen? Joel asks, is it okay for me to pay in yen? The farmer says, oh yes, that would be bien. Bien literally means well. It can also mean fine, depending on the context. You're very likely to hear this word along with muy. If you ask someone how they're doing, they're likely to say, muy bien. This word can also be used to describe how pretty much anything is happening. For example, how is the vegetable business going? Oh, it's going bien. We're going to continue to use this stand to answer the question of how. So most questions that start with how can be answered with a word from this vegetable stand, an adverb related to quality or the way that something is done. Joel asks this question, how, when he sees the monkey's hair. He thinks it looks really cool, parted on the side and slicked back, kind of like the con man's hair. Joel asks, how can I get hair like that? The farmer answers, that's easy. Just comb it as I do. Then he pulls out a comb and proceeds to comb the leaves of a carrot in the middle of the stand. But here's how he says it. He says, just comb it como I do. So the word como basically means as. Now in English, we often change this word out for how or like. Instead of saying comb it as I do, we might say comb it like I do or comb it how I do. In each of these cases, you would use the word como in Spanish. For now, remember that it means as, but remember that it can be also translated as how or like. As an example, the two of them are as one. That would be, the two of them son como one.
Las dos son como una.
When the monkey starts combing the carrot's leaves, Joel's a bit discouraged. Personally, he doesn't have hair, so he has nothing to comb. He's so upset about this that he just flies straight home without actually buying anything today. Now, we're about to follow Joel home, but first, let's review the marketplace really fast. See if you can remember how each of the words that we've learned is used. In the middle at the statue, we have no and si. At the steak stand, we have muy. At the bread stand, we have ya. At the fruit stand, we have aquí. And at the vegetable stand, we have bien and como. All of these words are adverbs. When we go to Joel's home, we're going to learn two types of words that we've never seen before in this course. We have adjectives in his yard and nouns inside the house. We're about to learn just one of each of them. On Joel's driveway, he has a blue car. Joel loves his car, and he considers it to be the standard of all beauty. So basically, he compares anything else he sees to this car. In fact, he idolizes this gorgeous car so much that he never even drives it. So it simply sits on his driveway, growing moss. So every time Joel comes home, he sees that there's more moss on his car. And his word for more is más. So as an example, more food would be más food. The example sentence that we're about to hear actually uses the word más to mean something more. See, the word más doesn't just mean more. It actually also means else. Spanish doesn't have a word for else, so Joel always just uses his word for more. So to say someone else, he just says someone more or someone más. And to say something else, he would say something más. Here's the example. The sentence is, "And does anyone else in the family know about that?" So this is, "Y does anyone más en la family know about eso?"
¿Y alguien más en la familia sabe sobre eso?
Let's listen to that example just one more time. And does anyone else in the family know about that? ¿Y does anyone más en la family know about eso?
¿Y alguien más en la familia sabe sobre eso?
Finally, let's go inside. Joel's house is full of many strange things, and we'll explore a lot of them later in this course. But for now, we'll go straight to his bedroom. Joel has lots of objects crowding all around his bed, which I think must make it hard to sleep, but the most distracting thing of all is probably the crowd of toads that cover his floor. These toads cover almost all of the floor, and the word todo means all. So when Joel says all the floor is covered with toads, what he says is todo the floor is covered with toads. In future lessons, we're going to be using Joel's bedroom to learn words related to amounts or parts of something. The most common of these words is all or todo. Now, just like in English, this word is usually used before a noun, but also with the word the. So we don't just say all world, we say all the world. We also tend to say all the people and things like that.